speaker this morning, Nancy McGimsey, the singer, as you now know, a published songwriter and a public speaker. She's been writing songs since she was 16, is that right, Nancy?
Yes.
16. And singing professionally at spiritual retreats, seminars, and worship services for over 20 years, both here throughout the South and throughout the country. Welcome, Nancy, to our pulpit.
Thank you so much. It's an honor and privilege to be with you today. Wow, it's almost 2015. Can you believe it? And as we approach this new year, many of us have valid concerns about the state of the world as it is. But in this season, when many of us are wishing for peace on earth, we must remember that in order to work toward peace on earth, we must first work toward peace, creating peace in our own hearts. Mahatma Gandhi said, "You must be the change you wish to see in the world." So if we wish for peace on earth, then we must be a living example of peace, love, and compassion. If I want peace, then I must be an active peacemaker. I must be a practitioner of peace and a distributor of love. We create our own mini worlds, our own microcosmic worlds, if you will, by our words, our thoughts, our deeds. We also affect and create those mini worlds and the larger world with our energy and vibration. Everything essentially is made up of energy and vibration. I remember sitting in science class when I was just a teen, and I was listening to my science teacher tell me that the only difference in my body form and the body form of that chair he was pointing at was the rate at which the atoms were vibrating. Now, I'm sure that quantum physics has come a long way since I was a teenager, but it still really blows me away to think that the scientists are still proving what the mystics have known for centuries, that there is this vibration that moves through all creation. I call it the holy hum. It's sort of this buzz that, it reminds me of that song from the 60s, "The Sound of Silence." Remember that song? And when you're totally still, you still hear this little sound, even when you get completely still and silent. There is a holy hum that is buzzing through all creation. Excuse me. So if I want to add to the peace, then I need to attune myself to that peaceful vibration. I encourage you to make a daily practice of some sort of peaceful attunement, whether that is deep breathing, meditation, yoga, contemplation, Tai Chi, or perhaps you have a time every day when you sit quietly and pet your purring cat. Whatever brings peace to your heart. And why is it important every day? It's sort of like when you leave, and I do this frequently, leave the guitar in the corner, and then you go pick it up. It's not in tune anymore. It helps us to tune ourselves to that vibration on a daily basis, to bring peace to our own hearts, to bring peace to our own homes, and then we are more able and more apt to go out in the world and exude a peaceful energy. Our energy and our vibration has the power, whether we are giving out a negative or a positive vibration, it has the power to affect the workplace, to affect the highway, and thus to affect the greater world. This is from "Peace is Every Step" by Thich Nhat Hanh. If in our daily lives we can smile, if we can be peaceful and happy, not only we, but everyone will profit from it. Our smile affirms our awareness and determination to live in peace and joy. The source of a true smile is an awakened mind. I want to take a moment now to do an exercise. Many of you are already doing some form of peaceful attunement every day. But I would just like to share what works for me. It was over 20 years ago when someone told me about a word that I like to use in a chanting or singing way every day. I do this for 20 minutes every morning. And it brings me a great deal of peace. It is a word with very high vibration. And people of all faiths use it to bring peace, calm, and to raise the consciousness. It is spelled H-U, and it's pronounced hue, like the color or shade. And I sing it on the out-breath, and the reason I like it better than some words is that a lot of them cut off, like om cuts off, and this one continues that vibration, and I really like that, and it tends to get me in a roll with it. So if you'd like to try it, close your eyes if you like, and first think of something to get your heart in the right space. Think of something or someone or a scene that brings peace and calm and joy and love to your heart. That's a good way to start with any meditation activity, is to fill your heart with love. So close your eyes if you like, and we'll just sing this 4 or 5 times. Whenever you're ready. Now we're calm. Now we have peace in our hearts and we have peace in our homes. And now we have to go out in the world. I lived in the Atlanta area for about 17 years. And I admit reluctantly that for many years I reacted. I just reacted to that aggressive driver. And let's say someone would cut me off in traffic, and then they would shoot a gesture, and then they would start fussing at me, and I would toot the horn, and then I would get angry. And that's where I learned some things about energy, though. You could feel a wave of negative energy. I would feel it coming over me, and I would feel it on the road, and as I drove, I would feel this yucky. I love to use the word yucky. I mean, kids have it right. That's just a word that perfectly expresses how that feels. It's just yucky. And you feel yucky the whole way to work, and you feel yucky when you get to work, and you set your day off that way. And I often joked that I was in Atlanta to learn patience, because I often lived out and had to drive into Atlanta for work. But it's like when you walk into a room and someone's been arguing. And even if they're not arguing anymore, you feel the tension. You've heard the expression, you feel the tension in the air. That's because everything's made up of that energy and vibration. You can actually charge the atoms in the air with negativity. Just like, by the same token, someone very peaceful and calm can come into a room and you feel their serenity. Because those atoms are able to be charged with that energy. And so it's very easy to react to negativity in the workplace, in the home, on the highway. But we can also choose to tap into that peace and not react, or react in a loving manner. Being peaceful is not a passive role. It takes mindfulness, it takes determination, and it takes devotion. That's why the daily practice is so important. Mahatma Gandhi said, "The weak can never forgive. Forgiveness is an attribute of the strong." I learned a wonderful forgiveness technique one Sunday morning when I was singing in Huntsville, Alabama. The speaker said, instead of getting angry with someone for their negative behavior, try wishing them what they don't seem to have. And he was talking about his relationship with his father. But I realized that one of the places that I was having the most trouble was on the highway. I was living at the time in Acworth, Georgia, and I was driving down I-75 southbound in the morning and back in the afternoon, and it was just horribly congested. So I decided to try this technique. Monday morning, after that service, an aggressive driver started cutting people off in traffic, and I took a deep breath, and I said, "I wish you peace and contentment." And there's a big difference in saying, "I wish you'd quit acting that way," and then sincerely and lovingly wishing someone that they don't have. There's a big difference. I'm not talking about saying, "I wish you'd quit acting." But I said, "I wish you peace and contentment." And then I followed the car with my eyes, and I kept saying sincerely from my heart, "I wish you peace and contentment. I wish you peace and contentment. I wish you peace and contentment." And an amazing thing happened. I really enjoyed my ride to work, even though the traffic was horrible. It was a Monday morning. So what we're really talking about here is not changing that other person. It's about changing our own hearts. But our energy can change that energy on the road. Another technique that I came up with one time, I was on my way to see someone and I was worried that we were going to get into an argument. And I don't have time to get into the whole story, but I was really nervous. And I was on my way in the car going, "Okay, what if we get into an argument? What am I going to do?" And I realized at some point that this projecting the argument, this expecting the argument was going to lead to, guess what, an argument. You know, I was putting that out there and expecting it. I'm like, you're gonna get into an argument if you don't change how you're feeling about this. So on the road, I just started singing this song, and it's sort of a mantra. It's really more of a mantra than a song, but I was singing it because I do that. And so I started singing this over and over again, and when I got there, we got along just fine. And so I thought I would do another exercise here and give you a chance to bring to mind some situation that you may not be looking forward to. It could be a doctor's appointment. It could be a meeting with your boss. It could be some situation that's coming up that you're just a little nervous about, or a situation where you have to deal with someone who may be a little difficult. Or it could be something totally different. You just want to bring love to a situation. But bring that to mind. Maybe close your eyes if you like. And as I sing this song, visualize yourself arriving in that situation and just bringing your most loving, peaceful self to it and see it turning out beautifully. I come in peace, I come in love, I come in peace and love, I come in peace, I come in love, I come in before I make that turn down your street. I come in peace, I come in love, I come in peace and love. I come in peace, I come in love, I come in peace and love. I'll use the law of silence. If I cannot find kind words to speak, I come in peace, I come in love, I come in peace and love. I come in peace, I come. I come in peace and love. I come in peace. I come in peace. I come in peace. You can open your eyes whenever you're ready. By bringing your best to a situation, you can manifest a peaceful outcome. I do a lot of driving. Obviously, most of my stories are coming from the road. It's just the nature of what I do, driving to sing and driving to speak. And I've noticed both as a passenger and as a driver that it's easy to be judgmental toward other drivers on the road. You know, if someone drops a plate in your kitchen and it breaks, you're not likely to say, "You idiot!" or "You jerk!" You know, but we tend to, I've noticed this with other people as well, they'll shout things out and I'm like, "Wow, this is my peaceful, loving friend, what's going on here?" And I've been doing a lot of thinking about that, and I think that there's two main reasons. One is that there's much more at stake. You know, somebody drops the plate, you clean the plate up, you've lost the plate, who cares? But someone makes a mistake on the road, it could end you. You know, it could be an accident, it could be a big bunch of trouble, it could be hardship with your health, it could cause death. So we tend to put a lot more on those mistakes. They mean a lot more. But I think a bigger reason is that we don't know that person. We don't know that, generally. We don't know who that is in that car. So it's easier to slap a label on them. And I think that's where the lesson is. Late in 2012, I found out that I had stage 3 breast cancer. I had a huge tumor in my right breast that was growing at a 98% growth rate. And my sister, my only sister, died of breast cancer in 1997. I was terrified. I was on my way to my first oncologist appointment. And I never wanted to go see an oncologist. I never wanted to make that decision about chemotherapy. I was sitting in a stoplight with my phone at my ear, my cell phone at my ear, and I was calling my partner to make sure that she was at the doctor's office and to tell her that I would be right there. And when the light turned green, I put my foot on the accelerator, but apparently not fast enough, because the man in the truck behind me started blasting his horn at me. He was apparently angry because I was using the horn. He started blasting his horn, and when I looked in the rear view, he was gesturing and yelling at me. And I was shocked, because I was feeling so fragile. And I was so full of emotion about my situation that I didn't have time to handle that, too. But the gift in that was that I could see something that I might not ordinarily see by not reacting to him, by being so full of my emotion. In that moment, I was able to realize the importance of compassion behind the wheel, the importance of compassion toward that other driver that we probably don't know, and we don't know their situation. I really believe, honestly in my heart, that if he had known what I was going through, he would not have done that. We don't know what that person is going through. We don't know why they may need to use their phone. We don't know why they swerved in the road back there. We don't know why they're in such a hurry. I don't even know why he was so angry. Maybe he had the worst day of his life. I don't know. Compassion. Compassion. Compassion is the attribute of the active peacemaker. The mind loves to judge. It's its job. But we owe it to the role of peace to override that judging mind and give compassion. Practice compassion. Wish them what they don't seem to have. The Dalai Lama said, "If you want others to be happy, practice compassion. If you want to be happy, practice compassion." I would like to end on this note. This is by Ram Dass. And when I read this, it really moved me because I love to exercise by hiking. I love to go out in the woods, and I love trees. And I especially love chestnut oaks. We have a lot of chestnut oaks up in the mountains where I'm from. And they're very gnarly, and some of them have holes in them, and they, I sometimes call them the Winnie the Pooh trees, because they have a big hollow place where you could imagine Winnie would be popping his head out. And I love those trees, so I was really moved by this, and I love anything that gives me another angle on compassion. This is by Ram Dass. When you go out into the woods and you look at trees, you see all these different trees, and some of them are bent, and some of them are straight, and some of them are evergreens, and some of them are whatever. And you look at the tree and you allow it. You see why it is the way it is. You sort of understand that it didn't get enough light, and so it turned that way. And you don't get all emotional about it. You just allow it. You appreciate the tree. The minute you get near humans, you lose all that. And you are constantly saying, you're to this, or I'm to this. That judging mind comes in. And so I practice turning people into trees, which means appreciating them just the way they are. I wish you all a new year full of joy, peace, and compassion.